How does the weather work in Breath of the Wild? With such a huge world, all of Hyrule's different biomes contain their own unique weather patterns, climates, and even weather phenomena that make this world feel dynamic. We'll be sharing all the interesting details and intricacies about the system today, all discovered through the passion of self-meteorology. So how does the weather work in Hyrule? With all the different climates, Breath of the Wild is split into 20 different climate zones, which each feature their own unique weather cycles and temperatures. And we'll start by discussing the weather. Every 4 in-game hours, or 4 real-life minutes, the weather will move on from one pattern to the next, which is clearly indicated by the forecast you can see on your bottom right. And this forecast is determined by the climate zone you're currently in, as each of them are different. The Central Hyrule Plains climate, for an example, features blue skies 60% of the time, cloudy skies 20% of the time, rain 10%, heavy rain 5%, and thunder another 5%. These are the percentages that determine the weather cycle of the region you're currently in. And every time a new pattern is forecasted, it uses these specific odds to determine the new weather. And whenever you move into a new region, it makes a new forecast in correspondence to the new region's climate zone. So beyond the Hyrule Plains, some regions are a lot more sunny, such as the arid Tabanthas near perpetual blue sky at 94%, with just a 4% chance of cloudy and 2% chance of rainy, meaning it only rains on average one block every 8 days here. Meanwhile, the humid Farron region rains about 30% of the time between normal and heavy rain, with even more inclement weather within the subtropical jungle zone nearby, adding more cloudiness and storms. These two regions are amongst the rainiest areas in the game, as all future weather patterns here have a 30% chance of receiving rain in some fashion, which is tied with the temperate Zora climate, North Hyrule Plains climate, and the Dark Woods as well. Which surprisingly, all these regions are rainier than the infamous Akala, which was said by many fans to be the rainiest region in the game, when in reality it's just amongst the cloudiest. The only important thing to note here is that all rain and heavy rain and cold temperatures turn into snow and heavy snow respectively. So although the grass feature a lot of rain in areas like Hebra, the Highlands, and Mount Lanero, this is only really seen in snow form. And if you notice, none of these cold areas receive any lightning, which is pretty true for most regions in the world actually. It's super rare and is restricted to just 5 regions, at either a mere 5 or 10% chance. However, due to the fact that rain turns into snow at low temperatures, it is possible to go to a high enough point in one of these stormy regions to witness a rare spectacle, a snowy thunderstorm, which is super unique given that there aren't a lot of high spots like this. But this little mountain outside the edge of Hebra, Mount Drenna, shows this off quite nicely, and it's very cool indeed. We'll get more into how temperatures work though in a moment. Now, with all this different weather comes different weather phenomena, which are all weather conditions that bend the rules of a zone a bit. Sometimes, a specific event can override the normal weather cycle of what's supposed to be there, such as the never-ending rain in Lanero when you first go there for the Divine Beast, or the never-ending storms on the Thunder Plateau or by the Song of Storm Shrine, as these new patterns are meant to correspond with their pairing quests, and typically revert back to normal when they're complete. On the contrary, some specific areas permanently bend the climate rules of the region to be unique. Most infamously, the cold area on the Great Plateau, which goes against the rules of the main warmer climate zone it's under. These are all a case-by-case basis though, and I don't yet have a map of all of them. So sometimes if your weather forecast shifts into a completely different set without leaving the climate zone, this may be one of those areas. Finally though, the most infamous weather phenomena has to deal with the rain. Because have you ever wandered around Hyrule on a sunny day only for it to randomly start showering, despite not being on the forecast? It's totally random, but this is actually due to a mechanic called blue sky rain, which creates random sun showers that can happen for a short period of time during clear weather. This only happens in select regions though, specifically ones where rain is a normal part of the weather cycle, so you won't see stuff like this in the arid Tabantha or dry desert. Moving away from the weather of Hyrule, the other crucial half to this has to deal with the dynamic temperature of the world and how it relates to the environment. So Breath of the Wild displays temperature in the Fahrenheit system for the English version, but we'll try to provide both Fahrenheit and Celsius numbers for everything up ahead. So Link's temperature meter represents his sustainability in different climates, with the center 68 degrees Fahrenheit or 20 Celsius being neutral, 32 Fahrenheit or 0 Celsius being the point where Link starts freezing, which represents the real-life temperature water starts freezing, and 104 Fahrenheit or 40 Celsius is the prime danger temperature for heatstroke, which Link will experience here without proper protection. I should note that this temperature meter only reflects the current temperature of Link, while the temperature number on your map represents the base temp where you're currently standing in the world. Normally, these two values always match each other, but if Link is currently staying by a fire to keep warm, or standing in the shade to avoid the desert sun, this will be reflected in Link's personal meter, but not in the base number on the map. When Link is under extreme temperature though, his hearts will start to drain half a heart every 10 seconds, which although most players don't struggle with finding protection against elements, there's always things to do in the moment to help. Even things like shooting a fire arrow in combat will warm you up for a split second, which in turn resets a 10 second damage cooldown. I won't go over every method of environmental protection now, as most of them are pretty well known. But in terms of what actually determines the specific temperature of a spot in the world, this is again due mainly to the climate zones, which all have predetermined temperatures based on factors like elevation and time of day. For an example, the open desert can be around 130 degrees Fahrenheit or 54 degrees Celsius, which is determined by the game's temperature data for the desert region. On this, the left number reflects the height value in this game's measurement system. In this case, we're at about 150 units, which is very low as the desert is. And the right number represents the temperature in Celsius, which in this case we're at about 54, or 130 degrees Fahrenheit, just as it shows here. However, at nighttime in this same exact area, the game doesn't pull from this list, but rather the corresponding nighttime version of the Gerudo climate, which features much lower temperatures in the daytime due to the lack of sun. So here at the same elevation at night, our temperature is a much lower 22 Fahrenheit, or negative 6 Celsius, which is again reflected by the data. The day and night temperatures both reflect danger zones of the desert region, and although these temperatures are set in stone throughout most hours of the day, there is a set time window where the day temperatures start transitioning into night and vice versa. And that is 4 to 9 PM for the shift between day and night temperatures, and 4 and 9 AM for the shift between night and day. Since the temperatures are in transition between extremes here, this creates a Goldilocks zone in between these times where the desert isn't too hot or cold, but just right and safe for base travel. Other regions really don't experience a phenomenon like this, as the desert is the only one that has drastic day and night temperature shifts, while other regions' day and night shifts are a lot more subtle. Because in other cases, most regions have a consistent climate where wherever you are, regardless of day or night, the temperature difference is so minuscule that it doesn't affect the player personally. It's either too cold or it's perfectly fine. The only time where it does matter is with elevation, as the further you are from the ground, the colder it gets, which is used for several areas and challenges in Hyrule. The climb to the Akala Citadel Tower is a notable one, as by the time you start getting near the top, it's so high up that the player can start freezing. And this freezing may start sooner in your climb if you're doing it during the night where it's chillier. Because if we look at the temperature chart for the Akala region, it's very similar to most others. It gets colder and colder the higher up you go. However, if you climb this tower along with many other high towers, specifically when it's sunny during the day, you may not hit a cold fit after all. And this is where things go full circle, because the weather also has an effect on the current temperature of where you are as well. Sunny weather is actually the base, so it should be 34 degrees Fahrenheit or 1 degree Celsius on the top of the tower at day. But in cloudy weather, this subtracts the base temperature of a region by 2 degrees Celsius or 3.6 degrees Fahrenheit, which is enough to push this top area into the cold zone. And in rainy or stormy weather, the temperature is instead subtracted by 3.5 degrees Celsius, or 6.3 degrees Fahrenheit. So a region at nighttime with rainy weather and at its highest peak will typically mark the coldest that region can be. I think it's really cool that this game has a subtle detail with the weather, so if you're climbing a structure, doing it in the day and while sunny may run you into no issue, as this isn't the only area to have its tower temps be specifically suited around the weather and day. Hell, if it's nighttime and it's raining, this may be cold enough in some areas to start getting snow as well, as rain turns into snow below 28 degrees Fahrenheit or negative 2 degrees Celsius, which can apply to a lot of other high points of elevation across the world, such as the Drenna Mountain we were talking about earlier. But for now, it's really interesting to see the relation between all the different climates of Hyrule, with their own unique weathers and temperature ranges and how these can interlock to create unique environments throughout the world. And I'm glad that I could break all this down so we can understand the system one step better. My goal with this video and the entire Stats of the Wild series thus far was to make Hyrule a much more understandable place, and I hope between all these videos, there was lots of interest and entertainment to be found. Only great things are up ahead with this game's upcoming sequel, and we'll definitely do a lot with that game. But in the meantime, thank you so much for watching, and I will see you all in the next one. Goodbye!